evening training. It's indeed a privilege to be back in the auditorium tonight again, trusting under the leadership of the Holy Spirit to bring to you the message of the Lord as He gives it to me for the upbuilding of His kingdom, for the glory of His church. Is our intentions of this meeting tonight. And we're happy to see the auditorium packed out the first night. So we just trust that the Lord Jesus will continue to bless us as we go on from night to night in the services of the Lord. Now each afternoon they have a service, I believe, here. Each afternoon, is that right, Brother Ballard? At 2 o'clock, 2:30. And it's an instruction meeting. And I believe the best that I understood just a little bit ago, I'm asking the one day during the meeting to go up to the Apache Indian Reservation. I see some of them are in the meeting tonight to have another service up at the Apache Reservation. I'll never forget the meeting with the Apache. And now we're trying to make a date for that, and they'll see the missionary and so forth at the end from the Indian Reservation to make arrangements for this meeting. Each afternoon and each evening we'll have services here, the Lord willing, until we announce what day it'll be that we'll be going up there. And now we trust that all of you are on praying grounds and love the Lord with all your heart. That's the way to be. And now, to the many here, perhaps, are strangers, maybe your first time, how many has never been in one of our meetings? Let's see your hands. Never been in one of our meetings. Just look at the hands, isn't that? Well, to them who have been in the meeting, we, and with myself, we certainly welcome you to the first service. And now, may the Lord bless you and do something for you, give you the exceedingly, abundantly of His love and grace to you. And now, I was going to begin the meeting to just merely come and have an evangelistic service. I have noticed so much in my meetings going around that the phenomenon of this way of the Holy Spirit moves in the meeting has been very strange to the American people, because that there's such a mix-up among the American people. So many different denominations with so many different phases of which way they believe, and they become so indoctrinated with their beliefs and till they hardly know which way to go. If there ever was a place that's really has become a modern Babylon, it's America. I hope that it never touches the shores of Africa or any of those heathen countries. I hope that real, solid gospel teachers get in there for those people. Well, what causes these things to start up? Hungry, hearted children of God. People hungering and thirsty for God. They see something, and away they go and make an issue out of it. There it is. Separates brotherhood, tears up the church, but that's America. And I have said since coming back that I would, in the American meetings, to my many tens of thousands of precious friends that I value with all my heart, and some of the loveliest people God has in His kingdom, I consider as my friends in America. Thousands and thousands of them the Lord has given me. And I do appreciate every one of them with all my heart. And then I thought, after crossing back and forth across the country, I have noticed that one of the greatest things, difficult, that I have in my meeting, when I'm praying for the sick by the gift that the Lord has given me, not to heal the sick, I had no power to heal the sick, and I don't believe there's anyone else does. That lays in God alone. The only thing I can do is point you to the finished work of Jesus Christ, who paid for your redemption and your healing at Calvary. I don't believe there's anyone could ever save a person. Someone not long ago said, for the glory of God. Brother Branham, I got a little girl here that's crippled, and I want you to heal her for the glory of God, then I'll believe you. And it just so happened that there was an infidel standing there. I said, what more glory would it be for the little girl to be healed than it would be for a sinner to come to the Lord? I said, here stands a man that's absolutely an unbeliever, a perfect infidel. You save him, and I'll heal the child. I said, for the glory of God, this little girl will go to heaven if she dies in that case, but that man can't go to heaven in his case. Now, for the glory of God, you save him, and I'll heal the girl. There you are. See, it's all based on the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you was a sinner, you'd come tonight, you couldn't be saved tonight. You would have to accept your salvation that was paid for you 1,900 years ago. Jesus saved you when he died. That's when he saved you. But you have to accept it when he knocks at your heart. Then you accept your salvation. You accept Jesus as your personal Savior. He was wounded for your transgressions, with his stripes you were healed. You have to accept him as your healer on the same basis you accept him as your Savior. If that isn't the gospel, I don't know it, friends, of all these years. That's the gospel as clear as I know it. There's no man could save you. He can only present the Word of God to you. That's the only thing he can do. It's God's written Word he can present. You act upon what you believe, whether it's true or not. And then, in divine healing, is the very same thing. There's no man could heal you. Even doctors don't claim to heal you. They can remove a cause, something that the senses can see or feel, but they can't heal because God's the only one can heal. We haven't got a doctor that can build a tissue. If he could, he could build an arm out like this if it's been cut off. He could, you could cut a place up and go in the doctor's office and he'd build up the tissue and he'd come back out perfectly brand new. You go in the doctor's office with a broken arm, he'd set it together and knit it together and heal it over, come back out in a few minutes, your arm would be perfectly whole. You can't do that. The doctor can, if you got a place cut, he can sew it up. If you got a place broke, he can set it. But God does the healing. So God is the healer. And God is the Savior. Psalm 103:3 said, I'm the Lord who forgiveth all of thine iniquity and heals all of thine diseases. So it has to come through God. Now we want to approach this, my friend, sanely, reverently, and scripturally. It must come from the Scriptures. And if it's not in the Scripture, and the meeting is not carried on absolutely biblical and scripturally, then it's wrong. It's just some makeup, mythical, but not real. So it must come scripturally. We must approach it sanely and reverently and faithfully to believe it. Now, in the meeting, as they go on, I have noticed that many times people in wondering now that I can't get to no more than what I do, it's because of weakness. Not weak physically, thank the Lord, very strong physically. And when it comes to a place of preaching, or I guess I could preach 3 or 4 services a day and not pay any attention to it, as far as being weak. But one time of a vision will pull the life from you. Surely Christians can understand that. See, it's not me that does the work. It's you yourself. You're the one who does it. Your faith in God. I just stand as a servant. And then when your faith is built to a place till it pulls God, and God only uses my lips to say to you what he would say. Do you understand? When the woman touched the hem of the master's garment, for she thought in her heart, if I can do that, I'll be made whole. And she slipped off out of the yard. And Jesus turned around and said, who touched me? And the apostles were very much astonished because he said, everybody's trying to touch you, touching you. He said, but I perceive that I have gotten weak. Virtues went out from me. Gotten weak. You understand? One person gotten weak. And so he began to find where that flow was coming from. And as he looked around, he found the woman. He said, thy faith has saved thee. Not my power has saved thee, but thy faith in believing what he was. For she said, she believed in what he was. Now the one that smacked him in the face when he had a rag around his face, and he hit him on the head and said, now you're a prophesier. Tell us who hit you. We'll believe you. They felt no virtue going. He felt no virtue going there. It was unbelief. You must believe. He that cometh to God must believe that he is. Now you can come to God, how? There's only one mediator, that's Jesus Christ. But the minister is sent to preach the word, and you can hear the minister and come to God through the minister's message. For if the minister's preaching the word of God, the Holy Spirit that's in your heart will feed on the word of God. You get what I mean? Now, so therefore, it's not, that's what brings the weakness on. And it's for each and every one. There, each night, every day, we give out prayer cards, every day afresh, so everybody can get a prayer card to come. Whether you come in the meeting, or whether you, but you must come for the afternoon service for instruction. The prayer card must be carried by the person who receives it. Because the person must first come to the meetings and have instructions before they can receive a prayer card in exchange. So the person themselves, not somebody that never heard a meeting, knows nothing about it, come into the meeting, they'd never be able to receive healing because they don't know how to do it. You must know how to approach God for healing, like you do with salvation. Then, again, that it isn't a personal contact. The ministry isn't to personally contact. That's one thing that hurts American people. And for my own ministry, they believe that they must have hands laid on them or something on that manner. Because they've been taught that, especially among the full gospel people. The Nazarene, Pilgrim, Holiness, Methodist, Baptist, so forth, believes in the anointing of the oil. That's the way they've been taught. So they see something where you have to just look like and live. That's a little odd to them. In the foreign country, one thing in the supernatural, the whole group believes in one of them. Because they're not indoctrinated with different things. They just see it and know it's got to be supernatural. They accept it to be what you say it is. They don't class it nothing else. The Americans have mental telepathy, fortune teller, mind reader. The Jews, their theology in that day, they said, he's Beelzebub, the devil, the prince of them, the best fortune teller in the country, all such as that. And that's the way they fail to receive it. That's the way the American people are failing to receive it. But to them who really believe and approach it, no matter where you're at in the village, if you approach it regularly, it'll speak to you. That's true. Try it and see if that isn't right. With a full surrendered heart to do the will of God and promise him if you will and see what happens. Now, I said I would go across the country. I never get a chance to meet my friends. So just as soon as you meet someone, when the anointing is there, well, there it is again, right with the person. Then at night time, I'm finished before night comes. But I thought I would begin to see it. Ministers keep telling me, oh, Brother Branham, don't. But in California, in the Christian businessman, after the Angelus Temple, I've got to be there a few nights, then in the Christian businessman, God helping me, I aim to just preach the gospel on the basis of the shed blood and bring the people up and just pray for them as they pass by. I tried that in my tabernacle a few weeks ago. Out of about 100 and some people that come through the prayer line being prayed for, 16 outstanding miracles was performed before the people left the building. See? Just laying on their hands and praying. 16, that polio and crippled arms and twisted and everything was performed. This way, once in a while I'll get a person like that because I just, wherever I feel, I just pull a few people up here and get it started. May I see a person there, maybe here's something wrong with this one? I can see it, but there's no need to tell them there's space there for their healing. So I just don't say nothing, just go ahead. Here it is over here, here it is, here it is. But you, until you see something, if you're pretty sure it's going to be done, sometimes you'll speak to that person and speak for a bit. Now, for that. Upon the basis of that, if the first for healing, faith cometh by hearing and hearing of the Word of God. That's first. Then after that, God has set in the church apostles, gifts of healing, miracles, speaking with tongues, interpretation of tongues, and all those gifts He has placed in the church for the, in other words, for the calling together for the edification of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. God has set some teachers, evangelists, working of miracles, gifts of healing, all those things are for the perfecting of the church. Just like the members, Paul acted in your body, not just at Pentecost, 33 years after Pentecost when the Christian church is cutting orders. Those things will continue down. Now, come and pray with us. I love you. And I'm here with all my heart to try to help you. Try to help you to make your home a better place to live. To make the community you live in a harder place to do evil and an easier place to do right. That's the idea. That God will heal you, not just to show His power for healing. He doesn't have to do that. Look at the sunset, you can see His glory. Look at the trees growing, you can see His glory. Listen to these birds singing. They don't sow them, you know, do they plant, but they feed them. You can see His glory anywhere. But that your testimony of healing might be to the glory, that you might tell someone about it, that they too might believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. That's what it's for. Now, in this blessed word, talking with Brother Ballard, one of the chairman, I suppose, of the committee that has the chair, we were talking a little while ago, just before coming to the meeting, and I'm going to try to rearrange something for a few nights, and I want you to pray for me. Now, this is the Word of God. I believe every word of it to be the truth. And now, before we can open the pages like this, but it takes the Holy Spirit to open the Word to us, because we're blind in a dark world. And only Christ can do these things for us. So before we approach Him, let us approach the author of this word and ask Him if He'll just open it up to us, that we as children can look into it quietly, sanely, and fundamentally. Will you do it while we bow our heads just a moment in prayer? Our beloved Savior, we are so happy tonight because we can say from our heart, by the witness of the Word and the Holy Spirit, that You are our Savior. For our spirit bears witness with Yours that we are sons and daughters of God. It does not yet appear just what we'll be at the final windup when this world is no more. But we know that we'll have a body like His, for we're going to see as He is. What a glorious hope and a joy in our hearts. How could we feel bad and believe that if someday we're going to meet Him and see Him, touch Him, walk with Him, and say at the wedding supper, come out, take His nails pierced hand, wipe the tears from our eyes, take away all suffering, sorrow, entering into the joys of the Lord that's been prepared since the foundation of the world. God, let every man and woman in here tonight lay hold on that promise. Believe it with all their heart. And by believing so, they receive everlasting life. While we ask it in His name. Amen. Just for a few moments, I want to read out of the book of Jude, just one chapter. And It's the third verse of this chapter that I wish to read for our scripture reading just now. Beloved, I gave all diligence to write unto you of a common salvation. It was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. May the Lord add his blessings to the reading of his word. I'll just keep it a few moments for this, and you pray with me as God will take the word of God and by the Holy Spirit deliver it to every heart, just as we have need. Now, Jude here, writing some 30 years after the first beginning of the Christian dispensation, the birth of our Lord Jesus, and the beginning as the issuing in of the first dispensation, or the Christian dispensation, rather. Now, to make that clear, Luke 16:16 says that the law and prophets were until John, and since then the kingdom of heaven has been preached. John preached for 6 months in ministry, and Jesus was introduced by him. And then he decreased, and Jesus increased, as he said. Notice, Jude said here that he gave all diligence to write unto the church that they should earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. Now, that would, we want to think that that was our church. Us Methodists would want to think that's our church. We Baptists want to think that that's our church. We Presbyterians want to think that that's our church. We Catholics want to think it's our church. And we Pentecost want to think it's our church. And every one of us wants to think that that's what our church is doing. Now, friends, there's always one logical, sensible, fundamental way to see what that is. Let's go back and find out what kind of faith they had. Then if we got that kind of faith in our church, let's contend for it. That's the truth. That's the way to do it. That's really the scriptural and the only basic way that I would know to approach the subject. Now, notice it did not say, let us contend for the faith that was delivered to Israel in the wilderness. Let us contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. And in order to be a saint, it had to be applied to the Christian dispensation. Because the word saint comes from the word sanctify, the sanctified one, and the sanctification comes through the shedding of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hebrews 13:12-13 said, Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people, suffered without the gate. You see, saints then would have to be in the New Testament, contend for that faith, because it was in the dispensation of grace, and not in the dispensation of law. Now, then the first one to introduce the message of or the faith would be our Lord Jesus Christ. John just introduced the Lord Jesus, and Jesus was the product of what God intended for us to contend for. He was the whole of the Christian faith lays in Jesus Christ and our faith in him. Now, if we can only understand what kind of a faith he taught, what kind of a faith he practiced, then we can see by that, if the early church practiced the same thing, then we should earnestly contend for that type of faith. For it's a commission to us to continue, hold until he comes. Now, the first thing we find that where Jesus was born, and we know the story until it comes to the place of his great miraculous work setting in, or when he began to teach after his baptism. And if we'll notice quickly, closely, that God was in Christ reconciling himself or the world to himself. The Bible said that God himself dwelt in Christ Jesus. Jesus said, the Father dwelleth in me. So if you can find out what God thinks about mankind, you find out what Jesus said about mankind, and you'll know what the Father thinks about him. Even the Father himself on Mount Transfiguration said, "This is my beloved Son. Hear ye him." Don't hear nothing else but him. Now, then we'll have to find out what God's attitude towards, if we can find out through the life of Jesus Christ, what God's attitude was to the sinner, to the sick, to the prostitute, to the gambler, to the beggar, we can find out what God's permanent attitude is towards the same matters today. For he was God's expression. You believe that? God was expressing his attitude towards his fallen creation through the Lord Jesus Christ. He expressed himself that way. And now, I think Peter, on the second chapter, very well gives an example of what to think when he said there, "Ye man of Israel, Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by signs and wonders which he did in your midst, which you yourselves are witnesses." See, Peter said, "Ye men ought to have known that this was God's message to the people, for God was with him, giving out his message to the people and proving what his attitude was towards Adam's fallen race." I think Peter explained it good to the church. I think Nicodemus gave a very good description of what the Sanhedrin thought of the Lord Jesus. Nicodemus, the man, the ruler, who came to him by night. Many people laughed because he came by night, but he finally arrived. That's the main thing. You laughed at him, have you done as good as he did? He finally arrived there. He came by night and he said to the Lord, "Master, who's we? The Jews, the Sanhedrin. We know that thou art a teacher come from God. For no man could do the miracles that you do except God be with you." We know it, but because of prejudice, because of church affiliation, because of superstition, because of lack of spiritual knowledge, they could not accept him. "We know that thou art a teacher." We know it. "Come from God, for no man can do the things that you do except God be with you." That well describes the attitude of the Sanhedrin to the public. Now, notice, we'll find out what Jesus presented. In the beginning of his ministry, he was a man of great dread. He was a man to make himself conspicuous, any different from any other man. He dressed so much like other people, he could walk among men and they didn't know who he was. So if we were going to look for the Lord Jesus in Phoenix tonight, we could not look to a person that's dressed some different in a clerical way.
Amen.
He'd be dressed like an ordinary man. Is that right?
Amen.
He just walked among men. We couldn't look for some great theologian and scholar with some great amount of honorary degrees and so forth behind his name, because he never had one. Look at Nicodemus coming to him. Nicodemus was a scholar coming to a man that had no diploma. He was an aristocrat coming to a pauper. He was an old teacher coming to the youth. See the difference? But when he come with an open heart, seeking the truth. You come that way. Just come the same way with an open heart, seeking truth. "Seek and you shall find. Knock, it'll be open. Ask and you shall receive." That's it. That's the basis that Jesus said to come on. Now, Jesus, when he was sharing, he was a humble, ordinary man. Not so much as a raised, great, fiery preacher. He said his voice was not even heard in the street. He was just an ordinary man, but there was something about him
that people realized that those things, qualities that was in him, was beyond the ordinary man. They knew it was. Well, if they, and I've just said that he was God's example for all Christians, and he was God's desire, he was God's gift, and frankly, in himself, he was God himself, presenting the faith to the people. Now, we've seen, oh, I just love this part here, so watch what he does. What did he do that was different? We notice at the first beginning of his ministry, when he first started out, there was a man by the name of Philip got converted. So he goes out and finds Nathanael right quick and said, for Nathanael to come see who I have found, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Well, Nathanael was an aristocratic, upright man, very much of a believer, and he turned around quickly and said, could there be any good thing come out of Nazareth? Oh, friends, you don't understand. Now, for some of you people that just want to go to a big church because it's a big, beautiful building, and wouldn't come to a place regardless of how much you thought God was there, just because it's amongst a poor bunch of illiterate people. Let me show you how wrong you are. Did you realize that only true death and life come? Do you know out of corruption comes life? Did you know even your natural life comes out of corruption? Everything you eat is dead substance to bring blood cells. If you eat a steak tonight, a cow dies so you can live. If you eat a potato, the potato dies. If you eat kale greens, it dies. Something has to die to produce life. That's the reason through cold, formal, intellectual faith you can never receive Jesus Christ. You've got to die in order to be born again and live again. Out of corruption, Philip said, or Nathanael said, could any good thing come out of Nazareth? What a sin! Now, I think Nathanael, asking that question, Philip gave him the best thing that could be given and said, come and see. Amen. Don't stand off out here and criticize it now. Just come over and find out. You come here for yourself. That's the best way to do it. That settles it, doesn't it? Amen. Come see for yourself. Very good answer. So what happened? Nathanael, being honest-hearted, he follows Philip. And when he comes, oh, so much could be said here, but for the cause of time. Look, when he came and he came up into the line or into the audience, might have been in the prayer line, it might have been out in the audience, out there somewhere. But when Philip walked up, I want to find out now if I can introduce Nathanael to Jesus. And I can see Nathanael as mentally thinking, he walks up into the audience, and the first thing you know, Jesus standing there talking, praying for the sick, or whatever usually his procedure was. About 80% of his ministry was praying for the sick, so I suppose he might have been praying for the sick, having a line of people coming by praying for him. And all at once, I imagine that Nathanael said, well, that fellow is just a little different from the ordinary scribe. He doesn't try to dress so fancy. He's just an ordinary-looking man. Maybe I like his talk. And when he got to thinking those things, Jesus turned around, looked at him, and said, behold, Israelite, in whom there is no God. And in other words, in the Christian English version of it today, he would say, behold, there is a believer who's honest. Well, Nathanael thought, now wait a minute. I just come from over here on the other side of the mountain. Maybe started the day before. Now, Philip, my friend who got converted, come over and told me. Now, here I am standing here, and the man tells me I'm a believer and I'm a truthful man, which that's right. He said, Rabbi, you mean me? How did you know that? How do you know anything about me? I'm a stranger to you. Now, what was Jesus doing? Introducing to the world what God wants the world to have. going to stand there and say, uh-huh, you read his mind, that's what he did. He said, how did you know me? Now look how impossible this would be to me. Jesus said, now he was wondering in his mind, it couldn't have been telepathy. So he was wondering, how did that man know that? And Jesus said, before Philip called you when you was under the tree over there, I saw you. That's settled. He said, thou art the Son of God, thou art the King of Israel. That settled it. I can imagine the Pharisees saying, now, there he knew that. Now there's a trick in it somewhere. There's got to be something there. The man, and finally they drew that they couldn't figure it out because you cannot figure out God.
Amen.
God is to be received by faith, not by knowledge. You might read the word to and know every word, it will still be lost. You cannot figure out if by faith are you saved, and that through grace, not of works, lest any man should boast. But quickly, as soon as he's seen the phenomenon, he said, thou art the Son of God. The believer did. The King of Israel. He said, because I told you that, you believe? He said, yeah. He said, then you'll see greater than this. Because he's a believer. Now let's look at him again. That was the faith that Jesus was introducing to the world. Now he did not at one time, did I ever read, say to the people, bring me this one here and I'll show you I can heal. He never claimed to be a healer. You can't make the word of God contradict itself. Jesus said, it's not me that doeth the work, it's my Father that dwells in me. He doeth the work. One day he had to go up to Samaria, or to down to Jericho. Instead of going right straight down to Jericho, he had need of going by the way of Samaria. And when he got up there, he sent the disciples away, being about 11 o'clock, into the city to get some victuals. And while he was gone, a woman, as we call over here, ill-famed, came up to the place to get a jug of water. You'd almost have to go in the Orient once to find out what those things really are. So she came up to get the water about 11 o'clock in the day. Jesus was sitting over against the wall, probably sitting there looking down, waiting for her to come. So when the woman comes, that was perhaps fulfilled what the Father told him to go by. So he looked over at the woman. He said, bring me a drink. And they had a segregation in that day, racial, not like we have today. And he said, she said, well, it's not customary for Jews to ask Samaritans such. He said, but if you knew who you were talking to, you'd ask me for a drink. And I'd give you water, you don't come here to draw. Well, what if the woman would have believed him that way? But the conversation went on. To my honest opinion, Jesus was trying to contact the woman's spirit. Now, the scriptures plainly said that he perceived their thoughts. Is that right? Not like a psychic reader, that's the devil. And everything the devil's got, he patterned off of God. For God is the creator and the only creator. Dancing you have, that first started with God. The devil took it. All the things you want to see that the devil's got, he counterfeited it off of God. But Jesus speaking to the woman, till he found exactly what her trouble was, then he went right straight to the car and said, go get your husband. She said, I don't have any. Said, that's right. You got five. Now listen to the woman's reply, like Nicodemus. Jesus now, the introducer of the faith of the Christian. He said, you have five, and the one you have now is not your husband, supernatural. And she said, sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Now I know Messiah, when he comes, he'll do these things. The very sight of Messiah. What you call the devil today. Said, I know that when Messiah comes, he'll do these things, tell us all things. But who are you? He said, I'm he that speaks to you. The very sign of the Messiah. This Samaritan woman knew that. Said, I know when Messiah cometh, that'll be the Messiah time, that he'll do these things. Well then, if Jesus being the Messiah, you believe that? And is he raised from the dead? Is he the same yesterday, today, forever? But won't he do the same thing? See? Said, when the Messiah cometh, he'll do these things. He said, I'll need to speak with you. And she ran into the city and said, come see a man who told me everything, He never told her all the things, he just told her that. But if God could show him that, he could show him all things. That was the Messiah. The little woman had touched the hem of his garment and ran out into the audience. Her faith told that gift of God, for he was God through his lips. That's the reason, see, when the Father showed him a vision, it didn't make him weak. But when the people's faith poured through him, that's what made him weak. He said, I perceive that I've gotten weak. And he looked around, seen her, let her know that her blood is shed, had stopped, that she was healed, said, thy faith has healed me. If that was Jesus saying, and that's the faith that he taught, that should be the same Jesus tonight if he's raised from the dead. If he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, a blind man one time at the walls of Jericho, name of Bartimaeus, he was sitting there, crying, begging. He cried out to Jesus, perhaps thousands of people following him. How could he hear? Some of them heard, away with you, you fortune teller. Away with you, Beelzebub, the priest reviling him. And Jesus with the sins of the world laying upon his shoulders and his face at the Calvary. Knowing he was going straight to Jerusalem to die for the sins of the world. Pushing through that crowd. Some of them are, hail, Hosanna to the King of Jerusalem. Hosanna, Hosanna, screaming on every side. The priest say, you're crazy. That guy is a witch. He's Beelzebub, the devil. He's a fortune teller. Keep away from such a man. All that have him on. Old blind Bartimaeus said, who passes? And he started crying, thou son of David, have mercy. You think Jesus probably way out in the road there could have ever heard that man's cry? Not through all that howling mob, but what did it? His faith stopped Jesus dead killing his cat. Jesus stopped with the same things, in my opinion, that the woman did. Turned around. Said, by his faith has saved thee. With all that burden and concern had the destination of every soul that ever lived come on his shoulders. And he knew it. And he was going to pay the supreme sacrifice. And yet, in all that pressing on him, the face of a poor, illiterate, blind, ragged beggar, stopping dead still in his tracks and receive what he asked for. Not a priest, they didn't believe it. But an illiterate, blind, ragged beggar, that's what did it. Oh, praise God in the highest for such a Savior. That would humiliate himself and come down into the form of sinful flesh and be concerned about the poorest man that can live in the country. He was made poor that through his poverty we may be rich. Oh, man and woman tonight, believe him, he accepted. Now, one day he passed through the pool of Bethesda, St. John 5, and the people said that, or the scripture said, well, there's a great multitude. Listen close. Follow me now. Great multitudes of important folk lay there. Now let's see what they look like. How are this important folk, what's wrong with them? They were lame, blind, halt, and withered. What a mass of suffering humanity. Just a little while, as the woman had touched his garment full of virtue, And here comes the Son of God right through a mess of people like that for 10 times while sitting in this building tonight. Waiting for the moving of the water. A mother with a water-headed baby, a poor old blind daddy, one crippled up with arthritis. Sitting in blind, lepers, and everything else, twisted, lame, halt, withered. Waiting for the moving of the water. And Jesus, God Emmanuel, full of virtue, full of love, full of compassion, moved right through that audience without touching her arm. See, friend, you fail to understand between the spiritual and the natural.
Amen.
I've seen men who were theologians to the highest degree and know no more about the spiritual thing than a top would know about Egyptian night. See? They understand scriptural things, but not spiritual things. The Pharisees, very fundamental orthodox, but failed to understand the spiritual things, so they said he was a spiritualist. Or a devil, that is spiritualist. See? Because they've seen the phenomenal, and they failed to recognize it, because they were just letters altogether, fundamental in doctrine, but nothing in the vindication. Amen. I hope you see it. Notice. Now, those people come by like people today with the love. They talk about love. There's two different kinds of love. Agape love, filial love. Filial love, agape love, and filial love. One is divine and the other is earthly. Agape love, if you've seen a man going over, putting his arms around your wife, the agape love would make you shoot that man to the ground and kill him. Because it's human love that you love your wife that way. But a filial love, the love of God, would make you put your arms around him and pray for his lost soul, the lost brother. Turns you all together around. And that's why Jesus, full of love and compassion, passed through these people with love and compassion. But when we think, this poor man laying here, this poor child is to die, that is the gospel love. That's our love. That's our compassion we have. That's humanly speaking. But filial love is to do the will of him that sent him. Divine love. He passed through that crowd of all twisted and lame, halt people, went right over there to a man in a little tower. Now watch, Jesus knew, I'm coming back to this in a minute, Jesus knew the man had been there. And he hunted around until he found that man. Wonder why. Looked all through that audience until he found the man. Like he did to the woman. Looked through to find who it was, touched his garment. When he found the man, he said, "Will thou be made whole?" He said, "Sir, I have no one to put me to water. I can walk. I'm not crippled. I'm all right. But I've got a disease that's been retarded for 38 years. The man never said that, but Jesus knew that. So he said, "I've had a disease. It wasn't going to kill him, but said, when I'm coming to the water, someone can offer me the Lord step down before me." Jesus said, "Rise, take up your bed, and go into the house." He picked up his bed and started off. The Jews found him. They began to question him. Then he brought Jesus in and questioned him. And when they questioned Jesus, "Listen, what would Satan offer in a divine healing service if the mayor of the city was deformed and laying here to be healed, and here stood the president of the United States, the governor, congressman, and all of them, maybe with cancer or tuberculosis, laying twisted and bound, laying on a cot, and God would come around and heal some poor, illiterate, colored woman or boy?" See, that's the way God does it. You get what I mean? Go up here on the Apache reservation to heal an Indian, you don't even know his A, B's, and C's. God doesn't look at human fancy. He looks at the simplicity of faith. There. Jesus said to them, no doubt they said to him, "Let me see you go down and heal this one. I'll believe it." They said that to him. "Come on off the cross and we'll believe you." Put a rag around his face and ask, you perceive thought. You tell people what's wrong with them and so forth. Put a rag around his head and hit him on the head and said, "Now tell us who hit you. We'll believe that you're a prophet." He never opened his mouth. God don't clown for people. No. It isn't a stage show. If the church of the living God in operation, then notice, Jesus then, as soon as this was done, he said to them, listen at his words, St. John 5:19, "Verily, verily I say unto you, the Son can do nothing in himself, but what he sees the Father doing. Whatever the Father doeth, he showeth the Son." Is that right? Read it when you go home, the fifth chapter of St. John. Jesus said, "I can't do nothing in myself." Did he tell the truth? He had to tell the truth. In order to be God, he had to tell the truth. His words were infallible. He said, "I can do nothing in myself." Therefore, he didn't heal one person in himself. He said, "The Father shows me first by a vision what to do, then I will do it. Verily, verily, I say unto you," John 5:19, "the Son can do nothing in himself, but what he sees the Father doing, that doeth the Son likewise. The Father worketh, and I worketh the other two." Now, when Lazarus died, when he was sick, Jesus left the place. He went another day's journey. He sent for him, he went another day's journey. He just kept going. Very strange, wasn't it? But then he turned, when he seen the time that the Father had told him all about the vision and what was going to happen, he turned around and said, "Our friend Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I'm glad it wasn't that, but I go with him." And when he come to the grave, look, showing that the Father had showed him, said, "Father, I thank thee, thou hast already. But for thee, I say this because of thee to stand by." Then he said, "Lazarus, come forth." And a man had been dead 4 days, stood upon his feet and walked to get him live. Because the Father had showed him what to do. Now, at the same time, that was the faith that was delivered to the saints. Now we see if the saints kept it. Now, did they deliver it to the saints? You said, "Brother Brandon, you just talked about Jesus, all right?" Jesus said, "A little while, and the world will see me no more." The world that is called, I mean the world order. "The world will see me no more. No more. Yet ye shall see me." I said, sure, that was the disciples. See what he said. "Ye shall see me, for I," personal pronoun, "for I will be with you, even in you, to the end of the world." Is that right? Now there's got to be some world today that won't see it, and there's got to be some ye's that will see it. The Bible said in Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ is the same. Same in principle. Same in power. Same in love. Same in compassion. The same yesterday, today, and forever. Is that right? Jesus died and rose again, and we believe that he rose from the dead. He isn't dead now, he's a living. We try to make him dead, but he's alive anyhow. He's alive. Now notice, quickly, as we are drawing to a close, Jesus said, "The things that I do, the very same things that I do, shall you, even more than this shall you do, for I go to my Father." You say the word is greater. Look it up and see what it is. It's more. How could you do greater? It's more of it, because he could be all in every church everywhere. "More than this shall you do, for I go to my Father." Is that right? He was ascended up to God before he descended again in the form of the Holy Ghost. He was going to make the atonement, then return in the form of the Holy Spirit. And he said, "A little while the world won't see me no more, yet you will see me, for I'll be with you even in you to the end of the world." Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He gave that commission to his church. Now let's see what the church did about it. Peter was a key man. When he was in prison one time, all hope was gone, bound in shackles, a pillar of fire. An angel of light came in the building and loosed the shackles off of Peter's feet and hands, opened up the door before him, and delivered him from the pen.
Amen.
Peter was on the housetop, and a Jew not wanting to mix with the Gentiles, and God showed him a vision about noontime one day, and told him how to go up to Cornelius because he was praying and waiting for him. Is that the same thing Jesus said? Paul, on his road down to Damascus, was stricken and was blinded in his eyes. And down in Damascus, the gospel had been preached down there, and there was a man by the name of Ananias who had received the Holy Ghost. Some little full gospel pastor down there by the name of Ananias. And he had received the Holy Ghost, and he was in his room one day praying, knowing nothing about anything else, and he was a prophet. And the Lord spoke to him and said, Ananias, he said, here I am, Lord. He said, go up to the street called Straight. Give him a vision. He said, go lay your hands upon Saul that he might receive his sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. He said, Lord, I've heard great things about him, that he threatens the church and rested and so forth. He said, behold, he prayed. That changed it. Here went Ananias up through the street of maybe some other avenue to get the street called Straight, come down along the city fountain looking around, saying, now let's see, according to the vision, it was such and such a house. I said, look at it. There it is right there. Walked right in there, laid a man rolling in there, blinded from being stricken down from the pillar of fire that hung before him, shining like the sun in its brightness. And he said, brother Saul, amen. The Lord Jesus appeared to you, and all. Don't say I saw. Oh, that I had a vision. The Lord's going to tell me. There you are. Said to me, come lay hands upon you that you might receive your sight. Now, if one's a Christian, say, I got another fellow across the street here for you to lay your hands on him and get inside. He couldn't do it. He only could do it as God showed him to do. Amen. Said, lay your hands upon you that you might receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. He laid his hands upon him in obedience to the commission, what God gave him to do, the power of Jesus Christ and the resurrection, and everything God told him happened on the minute. That's the way God does it, yes. That's the faith that was once delivered to the saints. Paul, later on, how many we could call the characters and such things happening with the saints? Paul was out on the little ship. He told them not to loose from Crete, but they went out there and 14 days and nights, every hope that they'd ever be saved was gone. The ship was waterlogged, and there it was, bouncing through the waters, the people screaming they wouldn't eat, knowing that they'd never see their wives and families again. Paul, just as scared as the rest of them, walking about with chains on him, aiming at the old ship to capsize and go over. That'd be the end of it. No moon and stars, 14 days and nights, her pitching back and forth in the storm. No way to hold it or nothing. Little old Paul thought, perhaps he'd better pray through. For he was gone. All of hopes was gone. He was a man. No matter how much he was acquainted with God, all hopes was gone. Paul went out in the bulkhead somewhere to pray and stayed all night. The next morning, this little Jew went out and said, be of a good cheer. What's happened? For there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose servant I am, saying unto me, don't fear, Paul. You've got to be brought before Caesar, Lord God, and give all these a sail with you. How about it? Must this little old ship I saw in the vision last night, that it must be broke up on certain shore? Wherefore, brethren, he said, be of a good courage, for I believe God will be done just as he told me about it. That's the faith that was once delivered to the saints. Paul, while preaching, looked up on a man and perceived his faith and said, the Lord Jesus makes you whole. If you got that faith in your church, is that what's operating? Then contend for it. Earnestly contend for it. For the faith that was once delivered to the saints. I believe that Jesus is raised from the dead, church. I believe he's alive among us tonight. Can you believe it? And he should just now. And I believe that he will. I can't say he will. My faith lets me believe that he will, and somehow, do tonight the same things he did when he walked the shores of Galilee. That's the faith as far as I know it in the Bible. Jesus promised it. Jesus introduced it, Jesus lived it, God produced it through him, out of him, nothing but what the Father showed. The apostles did the same thing. They come against obstacles and could not do it. But when God showed them something, they went and done it. That's right. And that is the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. Now I want to ask you something now, as a close. If our precious, beloved Lord Jesus, the Son of God, in his resurrection power, will come into this audience tonight as a living being, in the form of the Holy Spirit, and will do again through you and I the things that he did here on earth, will you accept him as your personal Savior and have no more doubt in your mind? If you will, raise your hands and say, by raising your hands, you mean to tell me only one third of you will believe? What's left for you to do but to be condemned then? You mean if the Lord Jesus himself, how could you ever be forgiven? Let me say one word. What is the unpardonable sin? To reject truth when it's presented to you. Is that right? Hebrews 10 says, if we disbelieve or sin, same thing, sin is unbelief. He didn't believe it's not condemned already. If we disbelieve willfully, after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sin, but a fearful looking for the judgment, the fire of indignation, which shall devour the adversary. Is that right? What was the first told of Jesus? When he was doing the very same things that I promised that he, by God's help, that he will do sometime while we're in Phoenix. Maybe tonight, maybe tomorrow. I don't know. But asking you if he will, and the people come up and misjudge him, and said he does this by Beelzebub. He said, now whosoever speaks against the Son of Man, that'll be forgiven you. But when I'm dead and raised again, and you speak that and take that same truth to the Holy Ghost, you'll never be forgiven in this world and the world to come. Is that the gospel? That's what was presented to the saints? Never forgiven for unbelief when the truth is presented. Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, upon the basis of the shed blood of thy beloved child, the Lord Jesus, upon the witness of the resurrection of his being here, I now come to thee to ask for pardon and mercy for myself and this audience, that through thy divine grace, that you will overlook all of our sins and misleadings. Father, knowing that sin is unbelief, and I pray, God, that you'll wipe all unbelief out of our hearts. Father, we realize that we're mortal beings. We're now bowing our face to the death where we were taken from and shall return. And maybe before the sun rises in the morning, that we'll have to stand in your presence to give an account for every idle one and everything that we've done on this earth. Knowing that in a short time, yea, even science says now it's in sight, that the end shall come. And one day through Phoenix, before long, and through this earth, there won't be one stone left on another. She'll be blown into pieces by the atomic bomb to fulfill the word of God, which says the whole heavens and earth will be on fire in that day. The atoms of the earth blowing and exploding. Screaming and people reaching for the for God. He said, I'll only mock and laugh at you in your calamity. What a time. Father God, I pray in Jesus' name that you'll save sinners tonight. And while we have our heads bowed, I wonder if there is someone in here who is not a Christian. Just raise your hand and say, I raise my hand to God and say, now I accept. God bless you, sir. Someone else say, I now accept Jesus as my Savior. Would you raise your hand, anyone on the bottom floor? God bless you, sir. God bless you, lady. God bless you, little girl. I see your hand. God bless you, the little colored lady back there. I see you also. Someone else say, I now raise my hand and say, Lord, I now believe. God bless you, young lady back there with your hand up again. Someone else, God bless you over here, lady. I see you. God bless you down here. I see you. I now believe. God bless you, sonny boy. Someone else on the bottom floor, God bless you, sir. God bless you, sir. holding on now. See, the truth shall make you free. Jesus said, he that heareth my words and believeth on him and sent me has everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but pass in death life, because he believes on the Son of God. Someone else raised it. Now, you may have intellectual faith. You may believe it from the standpoint of the Word, but in your heart, in your soul, as the Holy Spirit ever calls you there, no matter what your mind says, something in your soul believes. If not, then you're outside of God, outside of Christ, dead, alienated from God, dead in trespasses and sin, a sinner bound towards hell. Would you raise your hand and say, I'm now raising my hand, God, want to accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. In my heart, something tells me that right now, I must do it. Would you raise your hand? Someone else on the bottom floor. May God bless you, little lady. I see you. Just one more on the bottom floor. Just make your decision just now. Now over to my left in the balcony. Would somebody up there raise your hand to God, not to me, just to God. Say, Lord, by raising my hand, I now accept my pardoning by the merits of the Lord Jesus, thy Son. I now accept it for my salvation. Would you raise your hand to the left in the balcony? God bless you, sir. I see your hand. The peace of God rest upon you, my Spanish brother. Jesus said, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom. You can't understand it. It's a mystic. A mystical thing. Until you're born again, then the very life of God comes in you. Everlasting, eternal life, Zoe, God's own life, comes in you. And then you're a part of God. You're a son of God, or a daughter of God. And then you see as God sees. You believe as God believes. Then you'll be a new creature in Christ Jesus. The Lord bless you now. I believe now we'll pray for the sick. I want to ask you something, friend. God can do more in 1 minute to convince people than I could all night preaching. I'm going to ask you if you will out there get your children in the area, and please don't no one walk around during this part of the service. Now, if you're an unbeliever, don't stay. Now, if you are a believer, and I remember, for critics or unbelievers, I am not responsible. So you'll know. Now, everyone, get you a place, be seated, and then just pray and ask God to help you, and God will bless you, I'm sure. Don't move around. I'll explain it later. I haven't time tonight. This is just one night. We can't get everything in one night. So I just ask you now to be reverent and get it. And be seated, if you will. Do this for the kingdom of God's sake. Now, how many in the building have prayer cards? Raise up your hands. The boy, give out prayer cards today. All right. You're there sitting right in here. Is this reserved for the... All right. The sick in here. All right. One. All right. He gave out a prayer card. Now, on the front of it will be my picture and a place for your name and address, so the ministers can have it if they want to look you up. And in the back here will be a letter A and a number. And it'll begin from 1 to 100. And let's line some of the people up here to pray for them. Now, remember, as I say, I am not telling anyone that I can heal the people. Only your faith in Jesus Christ will heal them. Now, I want, who has the prayer card number one? Let's see, is there number one prayer card there? One. Let's see, take the first five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Would you all come out here? See if you can get up there. If you can't, well, somebody can help you. And if somebody's dead, well, look at somebody, all five doesn't raise up. There's three of them. Where's four and five at? There's the other two. Would you come over here, ladies? Right over here to my right, if you will. All right, five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Who has prayer card number 6? Raise up your hand. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Let's see them raise up. That'd be 5 more. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Would you raise up right away? Those down so we can see where you're at. Stand up so we can see where you are. 6, 7, 8. Where's the other two? 9 and 10. But excuse me, lady. I thought maybe they're all sitting here. All right, come on, 9 and 10. All right, would you come over here? 1, 2, 3, 4. There's one more missing. Anyone with prayer power of 6 to 10, would you stand up? Look at somebody, maybe deaf and can hear the number call. Maybe somebody, would some of the workers or something check these two chairs sitting here? Maybe the people can't get up. Oh, oh, it's there. You have it. Okay, that's fine. All right. All right, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. All right. Now, who has prayer card 11? Would you raise it? 11? 12. Who has 12? 13. 14. Prayer card 14. 15. All right, let's see how that is now. Let's wait this minute and start with these then, start praying for these first. We won't have to stand as long then. All right. Did you have a prayer card call, sir? Come on out then, if you will. Now, will you all be real reverent and trust that the Lord Jesus Christ, in His infinite mercy, will show mercy to we the unworthy? Now, how many in the building, now be real reverent, listen close. How many in the building that does not have a prayer card, and yet you want God to heal you? Raise your hand. Just raise up your hand. Anybody in the building got prayer cards? Well, it's just solid all over. Nothing about it. Now look, to you without prayer cards, if the Holy Spirit comes and starts His work of the Lord Jesus here in our midst, I ask you, now these people here, that doesn't mean you're going to be healed. They're going to come in a prayer line. That doesn't mean it. You have just the same chance. Come back here and back up here, anyone you want to, if you just absolutely believe the plain gospel, Jesus died for that purpose and accept it. Now, if you'll do that and believe with all your heart, and He's working here, that you'll believe with all your heart that the Lord Jesus will grant that to you up in the balcony, wherever you are, see if the Lord Jesus doesn't turn around and vindicate the same thing to you. Now, if you'll do that, will you believe? God bless you. Now, let us stand quietly, if you will. Now that's good. Just be real reverent, be real quiet. Now, my son and my manager here, Mr. Moore, the other assistant here, Mr. Brown, and them that's on the platform, they watch. It becomes a subconscious. I do not know what's going on. I can tell it goes into another dimension. We'll explain it after some nights now, what happens, the best we can. We can't explain it. But what happened? You go into another world, and then we want to see you tomorrow night. Everybody be reverent. They watch, and when they think I've got enough, then they take you from the platform. Now, the only thing you need your mind up for is just to get the anointing of the Holy Spirit started, then your faith. See, it comes down here, and your faith operates. Now, these people in the line, there's not a person there that I know. Frankly, I don't see a person in here that I recognize outside of. I've seen a minister here, I thought a while ago that I knew. I'll be sitting right here if I'm not sure this is the brother that had the tabernacle. Look up right here, Brother Fuller. Is that right? Brother Fuller. Maybe others that I know, but I can't recognize them at this time. And the only persons in here that I really recognize at the time, right now. Now, you're all strangers to me. Now, if Jesus was standing here with this suit on that He gives me, standing here in person, and you people are sick, could He heal you? No, sir. How can He do what He's already done? Could He save you? No. He tell you, I already did that. The work when anything is finished, is finished. Is that right? The work, the complete plan of redemption was finished at Calvary. Oh, and you cannot, in no means, deal with sin without dealing with sickness. Because sickness is an attribute of sin. So, the work was finished. Now, the only thing He can do is send some good inspired preacher to preach the word. If you won't believe that, He might have somebody with the gift of speaking with tongues that He can speak and tell a person. If you go take this thing back or do something or something like that through interpretation, that's the same as prophecy. Or He has a prophetic gift that He puts in the church that magnifies, lifts Him up, and shows to the people. Then you are right where you're sitting, then you accept that. Then you're healed. See what I mean? Or then you're saved. You know. The Lord bless you now. As we sing lowly, if we will, just once. And everybody be reverent now. Your spirit was your faith,
in my spirit with the anointing of the Holy Spirit, see, to know what is wrong. Now, to the woman, if the audience can still hear me, the woman very conscious that something's going on. For she knows she's standing in the presence of something. Between her and I stands a light, real, bright, emerald-looking light, which is the angel of the Lord. And the woman is conscious that something's going on. And she shared for me to pray for her. And her trouble is a depressed mental condition that's bothering her. She's mentally upset. And she has also been real sick with a case of, it was in her lungs, it was pneumonia. She's had pneumonia and been very sick, and it's, those things were true, wasn't they? If that's true, raise your hand. Do you now believe? That voice was speaking then, what about my voice? It was my voice, but I wasn't operating it. I do not know what's wrong with the woman. Whatever he says on the tape down here, and you can read it tomorrow. Whatever he said is the truth. That's the truth. Now, the woman knows that she knows where it was the truth or not. She's a witness of that. What was in her life? What's wrong? Was it the truth, lady? Every word of it you say is the truth. And while I was talking or whatever went on there, something struck you, wasn't it? Because it's all alive around you. You're healed. You're praying for it to get cured of sinus. Your faith does it, lady. Them spirits call one to another. You got someone else you're interested in, haven't you?
Yes, sir.
You believe that God can let me know who that is and what it is?
I know he can.
He can. It's for a niece, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Got kidney trouble, haven't you? Is that right?
Yeah.
Something struck you there, Mother. That was a witness of the Holy Spirit. Go and you'll find it just as we have
humanly, not beside myself, but there's such an effect that takes on me. We're strangers to each other out this morning, Tommy, the sister. This is our first meeting time, as far as I know. Oh, I have prayed for it. When I was here the last time, I prayed for it. Oh, were you healed with cancer the last time I was here? Well, I thought how can you do that? Now, if the prophet told you that later on, or whatever it was, I bet I couldn't say. Now, I have no way of saying it. He just, of course, you're just coming through a prayer line. Tomorrow, I will never remember you. The only thing it is, it just picked up on the tape here, and I find it that way. Well, was you in one of these kind of prayer lines? Just like this. And just exactly what I told you, was it the truth? And what I told you would come to pass, that it happened just the way it told you, that you would be healed and lost? Or if it called you out of the audience in the chair, or in the chair, sitting in the chair, we're thankful for that.
Hallelujah.
Now, you're here again. I'm a stranger to you. I do not know you. I've never seen you in my life outside of that time, but nothing to know you. Now, if the audience will, the lady's spirit Phoenix, you know her. You hear our voice and share each other. This microphone picking it up. If the Lord Jesus, now she told me that she was been healed of cancer at another meeting while she was sitting in the chair. Perhaps like some ladies or people or whoever it is that's being healed out of there. Now, here she is as a living witness. Now, as the Holy Spirit will reveal to that woman what she's here for, it may be a financial, it may be a domestic trouble. I could not tell you. Only God knows. I don't. The lady knows that. I have no way of knowing what you're here for now. It's not my business. No way at all of knowing what she's here for. But someone here does know. And the faith that was once delivered to the saints is the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ in his resurrection. He could tell me what's wrong with her. Now, if he does, I'll be thankful. If he doesn't, I'll still be thankful. For I know he's here. And if he does, will 100% of you, everyone, believe with all your heart. Now, just a little closer, sister. See, the spirit coming from everywhere now. And, if, you know what I mean? When vision starts, I have no way of knowing where it's coming from. I just have to contact the spirit of the person. So. Now, just to speak to you just for a moment. And you don't have to look to me. Just look any way you want to. Just so I can catch your spirit. You believe it? All right. I'll be with you. Your faith heals you. You've been something wrong with the inside down here in the intestinal. It's you've had a few going to some kind of a place that's with something white over. It's a hospital. You've been into a hospital, and it's an operation, and they take something from the inside, pulling it out. It's the intestinal colon. They take out and cut. And then I see they're putting something back in its place. It's a plastic surgery that they're performing in the colon. And now I see it again. It's twisted around like this. And that's what you hear. That's the same thing. Those things, whatever he said, is that the truth, lady? If it is, would you raise up your hand and face the truth? You believe you're in his presence? You know your brother has no way of knowing your name. God alone is that night. Come here just a moment. on Heavenly Father, how the Holy Spirit is anointing here. Follow the instructions of my Lord, which says these signs shall follow the believer. If they lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. This I do in the name of Jesus Christ. God bless you. Pray. May God grant you your desire. Do you believe him with all your heart? Your real reverence don't move, you see. Your ever one, ever spirit's moving in here, you see. And when you change like that, it throws me out. But your real reverence, see. Keeps moving to the audience, you see. If you turn face the audience, you just feel it like, oh, I can't explain it. But I just have to follow what he says to do. You're aware of that because you're a believer. And you know that there's something besides this poor man standing around. You're suffering with a sinus condition. And you got a burden way down deep in your heart. See, your condition is minor, but there's something appeared before me. Yes, I see it coming back again. Oh, my. You are a mother. You have a daughter. And the daughter is doing evil. And your won't prayer for her. She's an alcoholic. And you won't pray for your daughter. Those things were said or true. Why did come here to see you? Oh, merciful Father. The God of heaven, give mercy and peace to this our beloved one. And may the deep desire of their heart, whatever it may be granted. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Just believe, have faith, don't doubt. Believe and you will receive. Please don't move around. Someday, glorious day, when it's all over, you'll realize. How do you do, ladies? Are we strangers to each other? We've never met each other, never in life. Well, but Jesus knows you since you were born. You know me since I was born. And perhaps back there before either was born, he knows before me here tonight. He's the infant God. He knows all things. Predestinated certain things to take place. Way before the world was ever formed. He foreknew all things. If God will help me to know what your trouble is, will you be willing to accept what he tells you to do? You will. Now, us being strangers, never knew one another, they give you a prayer card and your number was called. That's all there is to it. And then, but God knows all about it. Now, just believe that you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and believe me to be his servant. I have nothing I can do to help you. If I can't do nothing, it'll be what I told you about the Lord, that he loves you and wants to do for you. Now the only thing you can do is do something that will lift your faith up to a place to get what you come for. Isn't that right? There's really not much wrong with you. You're nervous, all upset. That's it, turn dark just a moment. It's I see a desert valley and a hill laying back to this side of it. And it's concerning a loved one. It's a daughter. And she, if I'm not mistaken, the hill that I'm looking from is to Tucson, Arizona. And that daughter is very unhappy. And she's suffering with a mental condition. She thinks she's going mad, going wild. She has walked the floor a whole lot. She does a lot of things. She's looking out a window, constantly faces that way, down that way. Those things are true. Now give me the handkerchief you have in your hand. Our Heavenly Father, Creator of heaven and earth, Author of everlasting life, giver of every good gift, send thy blessings to this one Lord. And I pray that when this is performed, that your great Spirit will honor faith, for I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. The Lord granted you, sister, the very Jesus, the God of your heart. That Jesus Christ, God's Son, that bleeding young man, you're trying to reach me, aren't you? Your faith. Just a little disappointed because you wasn't called a few minutes ago. You don't have to do that. You're trying to get rid of something, aren't you? Not exactly a disease, but temper. Fall real quick, get angry. Will you accept my words as being coming from the Lord Jesus? Will you believe me as his servant? Stand up on your feet. Put your hand over your heart. Raise your other hand to God. Our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, in this boy's faith has touched you, I rebuke the trouble that's wrong with him, and may he never be bothered again. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. God bless you. How do you do? Look this way just a moment. You believe? It's not just for the babies. If God of heaven will reveal that little baby's condition to me, and let me tell you what it is, will you believe that Jesus died to do for it, whatever it is, a sense of certain sickness? Now, that baby is suffering with something wrong with his, it's in the lungs. And that baby has three ribs missing and part of his lungs. Father God, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, bless this one who I bless in your name. In Jesus Christ. Don't fear. Go have your faith. Believe it? Look this way just a moment. Heart trouble that you forgot. You believe he'll make you well? Accept your healing out of that heart disease and believe that God will make you well. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, let this be so for God's glory. Amen. God bless you. Go believe in him with all your heart. Do you believe? Something strange from that lady with coffee. Made you feel real strange, didn't it? Because you do a lot of it at night time. The asthmatic condition is causing trouble. You believe it's true. Then you accept him now as your healer. And in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and you go through this on the face of Jesus. Just have faith. Something wrong with your side, isn't it? You got side trouble. Two of you there in the line. And the lady just in front of you, too. What? Jesus Christ makes you whole now. You have. God bless you. Ladies, stand right through here, little lady, with your hand up to your mouth. You know, if you don't want to arthritis, you believe that Jesus Christ will make you whole. You believe it with all your heart. If you do, you can have your desire. Just say, praise the Lord, and accept your healing. And God will grant it. Sister, you believe God. You know what I know, and know what you want. God alone knows it, doesn't it? God will let me know what your trouble is. Will you obey me as his servant and believe God? Then go eat your supper. The altar that is in your stomach trouble will bless you. You go eat your supper. God bless you. God bless you. I am a stranger to you, I suppose, sir. But around is a real dark shadow moving as I come into your spirit. You're dying. It's cancer. That's true. But you can live through Jesus Christ. Do you believe it? Do you accept it? Come here. Almighty God, in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus, heal the man of your Lord. Amen. God bless you. Go and believe with all your heart. Look this way, lady. Now, I don't mean to be looking at me. It's Peter and John saying, look on us. In other words, it catches the attention. You want to go with that diabetes and be made well? Let God make you well? You believe you have that? You accept it now? Or you go on your own vision? God bless you, honey. Pray for your grandmother. When you yourself want to be prayed for, you believe Jesus can give you new blood and take that immune condition away from you and make you well. Father, God, for this child who's doesn't fully develop yet, this little girl, I take her to Calvary in my arms in the name of Jesus Christ for a blood transfusion, and may it come. Amen. Bless you, sweetheart. Find your grandmother to come from you. Go take me some lines. How many want to love the Lord and serve the Lord? You believe that He's the Son of God? Every one of you that has been an unbeliever, and now you believe, would you stand up on your feet just a moment? Every unbeliever that now is a believer, accepted Jesus, would you stand up on your feet? Just remain standing just a moment. If God will hear my prayer for you, those things, you surely will all of this. God bless you, son. God bless you. God bless you. Just remain standing. Everyone else. God bless you. Up in the balcony, would you stand around the aisle? You seem like the whole thing's breaking in now. The Holy Spirit is here for you. Just everyone stand. Everyone now that wants to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and wants to be born again, would you stand to your feet just a moment? You'll see the glory of God. Stand up just a moment. Where's the minister asking where prayer is? Now, I'm going to ask God, and I want you to file your way into prayer room so you reach it. Heavenly Father, in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus, grant the forgiveness of sin. Jesus, you've raised from the dead, dear Lord. You're here now. Beyond a shadow of doubt, you're removing of all the evil of the lifetime. Have mercy upon the new time. Grant the healing of their body for every sick person in here. May every person here in divine presence be fully and wholly delivered of every disease that they have in their life. As your servant, I can give every sick person's disease in your location and ask you, Jesus, that be removed by every curse of the devil. And for these who are standing to yourself, salvation and the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Almighty God, if I have found favor in your sight, I pray that you will grant these hungry hearted people every desire of their heart through Jesus' name. I ask the people who stand to their feet to come to the prayer room right now.